This is Pete Fiends for Get Ready to Rock Radio. Friday the 27th of June, talking to... Oh, 28th of June, talking to Norman Roy. How you doing, Norman?
I'm all right, thanks, Pete. How are you?
Hanging in there, thanks. Bass player for the Blockheads, Wilco Johnson, and Top Session here. You've got a brand new album, your first ever debut solo album called Faith and Grace.
That's right, yeah.
What took you so long?
Well, to be honest with you, I wasn't intending to make one at all, but it kind of came together, you know, very easily after I started recording a couple of ideas I had with Gilad.
So did the idea come from Gilad or from you? And then?
Yeah, I had a couple of instrumental things I wanted to record, and he helped me with it, and he was the one that was saying, hey, you should do some more. And then my missus kind of got behind him and said, yeah, I think he's right. And kind of, you know, got me into it, and I started it, and unfortunately, very suddenly, my missus died, and I couldn't really finish it for a while, so I just sat there.
It's
and then a couple of years later, I got back into it, but, you know, when I pulled myself back out of misery.
Well, yeah, of course. What was it, because you had the gap, was there a change in what you originally wanted to do and how it ended up?
Yeah, slightly, because, you know, originally I was just going to do some instrumentals, but then Gilad was saying, you got to, you know, why don't you sing a little bit, and also he encouraged me to cover a couple of songs from, all, you know, the people I work with, i.e. Eaton and Wilco.
Yeah.
And I thought that's a pretty good idea, so that I covered Billy Dickey and Roxette from Wilco.
Yeah, which you did in... much slower arrangement. Was that his idea or your idea, or how did he feel about it?
I changed the arrangements, yeah. I wanted to do it, you know, I didn't want to do it like the Blockheads or the way Wilco does it, because it's, you know, my
already been done.
So I just thought of a whole new arrangement for both songs. But yeah, I did it totally different, slower.
Yeah.
Roxette, I did it with organ and horns and everything, yeah.
Yeah, it's a great idea. It's a.
I got Wilco to come along and sing it, and I sang Billy Ricky Dicky, and there's actually another singer on the album, Sarah Gillespie, sings the song that I wrote with her.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about her. How did you come across her?
Well, she's just an old friend. I've known her for quite a long time, and I like her stuff. I like her lyrics, and she's always, you know, always written some great songs on her albums.
Yeah.
So I just asked her if she would like to do some lyrics for me, and she said, "Yeah, brilliant."
It's amazing, really, that you and Gilad, given you're both really into jazz, that you didn't work together on a project before.
No, funny. Well, yeah, exactly. I mean, we've worked in the Blockheads for the last, you know, 15 years together, but.
Yeah.
Never really thought about it, as I say, until I wanted to put these instrumentals down, and then we kind of got together.
So when did you actually start working on this record then? Mm-hmm. When did you actually first start working on the record before?
It was just about 4 years. About 4 years ago, or nearly 5 years ago. Yeah.
Was it always your intention to include something of Ian Dury on there, or did that come from Gilad as well?
No. At the beginning, I remember when Gilad said, let's, you know, do more, why don't you do more and stuff, that's when I started thinking, okay, if I'm going to, you know, I'll need some more material, I'll cover one of Ian's, cover one of Wilco's. I've even covered one of Jaco Pastorius's, just as paying homage to Jaco.
Well, your hero, yeah.
Yeah, he's the greatest. And I did also a standard, My Foolish Harp, only because it was one of Patty's favourite songs.
Billy Eckstein, I remember him doing that, yeah.
Yeah.
Have you ever written anything down the years before this?
Musically?
Yeah, you, in your own right, have you ever sort of written anything before?
Well, I write a lot of the songs with other, collaborated with the other Blockheads.
Yeah.
You know, on a lot of material.
Yeah.
With Ian and the Blockheads.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, I've never really sat down and tried to do a whole album's worth of stuff.
No. Well, I mean, it's such an original album. I love the concept. And as I said somewhere in the review there, it's a jazz album, you know. I mean, do you think you're going to have to drag some of your fans out, Blockhead fans, over to the fact that this is a bit more jazzy than they might expect?
Yeah, but I think a lot of them will understand it because they know I love jazz and they've heard it. I mean, I've thrown in a lot of jazz things, even with Wilco when I'm playing.
Yeah. Yeah, and funk, of course, yeah.
I think I'll be able to do it all right live. I mean, I'll still be able to put it across to them. I mean, I know initially the people that will come to see me will be probably Wilco and Blockhead fans.
Great.
That's partly why I wanted to, you know, connect with them, with Binnericky and Roxette and stuff.
Yeah.
So I think I'll be all right, yeah.
No, excellent. This album's got a kind of autobiographical thread going through it. I mean, did that slowly emerge as you were recording it, or was that your aim?
When I thought about, okay, let's get down to it, I wanted it to be a cross section of everything that I've kind of done. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Exactly what you said a minute ago. I didn't want to purely come out with a jazz album that was going to alienate me from the people that know me.
No.
But at the same time as well, I was thinking it was a good way to sort of try and make an album that wasn't going to be what people expect. Because, I mean, a lot of people would expect a bass album or a jazz album.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like a cross-section of everything I've done. And, I have to say, I'm kind of claiming back my riffs.
Well, isn't that true? Especially on Norman.
Well, you know, in those days you couldn't copyright the bass riffs, so I kind of gave those riffs away. I saw Mick Jones a couple of weeks ago, and I said to him, "Hey, Mick, I've recorded the Magnificent Seven riff on one of my songs." And he said, "Well, it's your riff, no?"
Yeah, well, that's generous of him, yeah.
Yeah, you know, that's why I included the Frankie riff and the Hit Me riff, you know, the Hit Me riff and all them.
It's yeah. Well, they are your signature riffs, after all.
Yeah.
Yeah. On that track, my favourite track, Me, My Bass High, which is, for people that haven't heard it yet, that's a kind of autobiographical track as well and traces your career. But you missed out Glencoe.
Yeah. Quite a few others as well.
I know.
Quite a few other bands I missed out. But, yeah, well, that was a period from After Me Brother, but I do mention, you know, Charlie, Mickey and Johnny.
Yeah.
And Johnny and me were Glencoe, so... Yeah, there was a few bands I had to skip over because they...
No, I'm just...
I call it boys at a bad age.
Very good, nice phrase, yeah. Were you, going back to the Blockheads, were you and Davey Payne the Jazzers in the Blockheads then?
I guess so, I don't know. Yeah, I suppose so. Yeah, Davey was more out there than me. Yeah, he was, into Albert Ayler and stuff like that, who I'd never really heard of until I met him.
Really?
Yeah, and Eric Dolphy and all that, he turned me on to a lot of stuff like that.
Yeah.
But yeah, I suppose me and Davey were more jazzier ones, yeah.
And apparently you were thinking about getting, you know, people like Nick Cave or Robert White to sing on that.
Well, I work with Nick, I've done some solo work with him, a tour in Italy and Iceland with him, and Robert. Initially I had the piece of music and I was thinking, I was hoping Nick could, you know, maybe do a narrative over it or one of, because I love his words, his lyrics, he's a great poet. Or someone like Robert Wyatt. And I asked these guys, but I did say to them, look, you know, I sent them the track and I said, if you feel something for it, otherwise if you don't, you know, don't worry, because I don't want it to come out as I'm trying to get you to write something for the sake of it.
Yeah.
And they were great, but they loved the track, but they were honest. At least they said, and Nick said, he didn't honestly feel what, he didn't know what he loved it, but he didn't know what to come up with.
Yeah.
But I didn't push it, you know, I said, well, don't worry. And then a couple of weeks, a couple of months later, Gilad said, why don't you do something on it, Norman? I said, well, I haven't got any lyrics. He said, we don't need it. Let's do your story, and I'll interview you, and we'll edit it and try and make it into a piece that will fit, and it kind of came together very quickly like that. It was really good.
Well, the reason I asked you actually was because if you were thinking things like that, did you ever also think that you could produce this yourself?
That's interesting. No, I honestly didn't think. I know the production of the album, is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, really, because it's a brilliantly produced album. And
I have to say, on that level, that Gilad helped me a lot with that because he's a fantastic producer.
No, and it comes across.
He would have been a brilliant musician.
Yeah.
He'd done a lot of production in Israel as well when he was younger.
Yeah.
And I heard some of his stuff, and that's what just made me want to use him, because I just thought his production's incredible. He's very, very good in the studio.
No, the whole...
just knows what he's doing.
It's excellent, but I mean, I just thought you had a really good overview yourself as well, you know, thinking about...
I know what I'm doing as well, so put us together, we both... And then we also had Philip Bagnall as well.
Wow.
East Coast Studio. And he's another... I worked with Philip. I mean, Philip did the very early sessions for New Boots and Plantings, and that. We recorded... We demoed New Boots back in the 70s down in Philip's basement studio he had then. And he actually built East Coast, where I recorded the album. And, both Gilad and me think Philip is a genius when in the studio, so we both really wanted to use him as well.
Well, it's a great collaboration.
That combination was blew me away straight away, because, like, as you say, the production of the album is incredible.
I love the idea that the kind of musical collage you got on some of this and some of the voice samples.
Yeah, that's Ian. It's a track called Puppetry Park.
Yeah.
And I kind of made it, you know, I've had sometimes I have a dream about bands, well, like you do.
Yeah.
But in my dream, I've been playing with Wilco and then suddenly it's turning into the Blockheads and suddenly Ian's there and things. You know, it kind of gets mixed up in the dream. And I thought, I wanted to do a kind of collage of Ian and Wilco and everything live, and I thought I'd put it over my bass solo. So I was looking through all Ian's verbals, you know, we got and the talking he did and stuff in between. I was listening to a lot of stuff like that. In fact, that's where the name of the album comes from, because Ian used to announce me as the man with the face from outer space on his Faith and Grace. Faith and Grace being me for bass.
Yeah, yeah, it's great. Yeah, yeah.
But, I couldn't find that recording of him. There was a recording of him saying that from some gig. I couldn't find it. So in the end, I used the last gig we did at the Palladium. Is the one that you hear on after Billy Wiggy when he says 14 stone, you know, in the blue corner.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Going back to when Ian sadly died, was it always the intention that the Blockheads would carry on, or was that a decision you had to make some time after?
Well, that was a decision we actually had to make. I mean, for a year after Ian died, we didn't really do any work, but we had only hits on the site saying, you know, please do a gig, we'll come. So in the end, we thought, okay, let's do one, and we chose Dingles in London.
Yeah.
And we didn't have a new singer, but Derek, who'd been with us for the last 20 years, Ian used to make him sing a few songs at the end and all that when he used to come to take Ian off stage. And we just said, Derek, the fans know you. You come there and sing as much as you can. Phil Jupitus was around. And he said he knew loads of the words. So he said he'd come and help us, and a few other people like Keith Allen, Mark Lamar. So we gave it a go at Dingwalls, and it just went really well. And then we got a buzz for it because we still enjoy playing our music. I mean, it's, you know, we're proud of it. And
of course.
We've grown together as musicians, and we find new things to play with it all the time. So we thought, well, we could carry on, let's keep going. Keep our music alive, Ian's music alive, you know?
No, and I think everybody thinks that, and they've supported you to that end.
The gigs we're doing even today are going great. We did one last night in Cheltenham, and it was absolutely fantastic.
No, that's great. Now, going back to the Blockhead songs, a lot of which are written, or most of which are written by Ian and Chas Jankel, is it true to say that the band's overall sound, I'm thinking about the music, you know, as part of the songs, developed, you know, and came from specific band members like yourself?
That's Mickey. Something, you know, if you're lucky enough to have musicians that have character in their playing, you're going to get that.
Yeah.
I think Ian knew that, Chas knew it, well, we all. I think that's what we try and do as musicians anyhow.
Yeah, you know, good point, yeah. What was it, thinking about the Laughter album, was there a problem with the writing after Chas left?
A little bit. I mean, it was kind of like once Ian and Chas had parted for a while, Ian was kind of searching for new partners to write with, and so he was wanting to experiment writing with everyone.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's how Laughter came about, because Wilco joined us by then.
Yeah.
And there's quite a few songs on there that Wilco wrote as well with
him. Yeah.
And you can notice, like, for example, Superman's Big Sister and stuff like that.
Yeah.
The style changed musically a little bit, you know.
Yeah. Just going back to your own post, Ian, again, when you recorded Where's the Party, it was described by some critics as being sort of Tower of Power meets Steely Dan, I mean, was that the point when you realised you could do something in your own right after Ian?
But I think that did help us doing that one album, because it gave us a chance to try and do something on our own. But what we found after that was we wanted someone like Derek to be singing all the singing rather than us trying to help. I think there was Johnny and Chaz were singing a couple of songs on that album, and it kind of made it a bit like it didn't sound like it was the same
band sometimes. No. Let me ask you something completely different, because I've only got a limited amount of time here. Okay. What was it like working with Don Cherry for you, being a huge jazz fan?
Don Cherry was an unbelievable, fantastic musician, but a beautiful guy, and he was just like a real calming influence on the Blockheads at that time as well, because, I mean, he was a lot older than us, and he saw us playing in Norway, and he came to a concert, and he came backstage, and he was saying how much he enjoyed it, and we were blown away, and we were like, this is so good. And then he said he'd love to come and jam with us. So we said, hey, you can come on tour with us anytime, you know, stay here as long as you like, play when you want and play what you like. And
wow.
He just came on, and then he played with us, finished that tour in Norway, and then carried on, came over to England and toured with us here. And as I say, he was just such a cool guy to have on the road. He just, what a lovely guy. And being slightly older than us, it was a real calming thing for the block. He kind of calmed us down a little bit, I think, in our wildness.
Yeah. I'm thinking about Ian again, and particularly his lyrics. How did he used to approach the band to get his lyrics across to you and then form a song? How did that work?
He just brings sheets. I mean, he had sheets of paper with words on, basically.
Yeah.
All over his place. You go around his house, there'd be hundreds of bits of paper lying around. You could pick any one of them up, and they'd have fantastic little snippets of verses and things on it, and you'd pick it up and go, oh, Ian, this is brilliant. He'd go, no, I've got a better one here, look at this one. And, you know, it was always like that with Ian.
Amazing.
I remember the first time I ever met Ian, the first lyric I ever saw was Clever Trevor.
Right.
I was looking at it, and I was reading it, and I just thought, this is incredible. I've never read a lyric like that, and yet it blew me away, because, I mean, no one was writing lyrics like that, just because I ain't never had no nothing worth having ever. You ain't got the cool, I think I wouldn't call them, thinking I'm not too clever. I was like, this is genius, you know.
It's a huge loss. Now, are you going to, just going back to your solo album, are you actually going to be able to do any dates to support this in your own right, Norman?
Yeah, I'm going to launch it at Rough Trade at the end of July.
Great.
I think that's the 24th of July or something. And then in October, November, I'm going to go do an autumn tour. About 16 gigs around this country.
That'd be fantastic.
My band, yeah.
And who will be in that band?
Hopefully, as many of the musicians that are on the album are doing it. I mean, I know Gillard will be doing it with me, and Frank, and Azaf, and possibly if Azaf can't make it, Dylan, because they're both on the album, and Sarah's up for it. So I'll pretty much have whoever's playing on the album. I've got Ollie on the album from the Average White Band. He's an old friend
of
mine. And, he hopes he can get over to do the tour. I'm keeping my fingers crossed, and you never know if Wilco's still around. He wants to be there.
That would be fantastic. So for anybody who wants to buy the album, what label is it on?
It's on Cadiz.
Yeah.
The same label Wilco stuff's on, and the same, you know, label that did his book. Wilco's book and Oil City, and all, it's all those people.
And can people get it from your website and stuff?
Yeah.
And all the usual outlets.
Yeah, it'll all be up there and everything, yeah.
Norman's been an absolute pleasure. Just stay with me, I'll have a chat in a minute. It's been Pete Fiennes from ForgetReadyToRock.com talking to Norman Watroy. The album's called Faith and Grace. What's the actual issue date, Norman?
I think it's going to be the end of this month, the 30th of June or something like that, yeah.
But by which time the reviews should have all come out. It's a great, very, very original album. All the best with it, mate. Thanks for talking to us.
Thank you.
Been an absolute pleasure.